Antoine Laurent Lavoisier, was born in Paris in 1743 and was executed in the same city in 1794. His father was a lawyer and his mother died young, so he was raised by one of his aunts. He was educated at the College Mazarin and received his bachelor's degree in 1764. Lavoisier both worked as a collector in the state service and showed great interest in scientific studies. He achieved achievements such as membership of the academy and salaried membership. In 1780, he became a taxman. Lavoisier's work was especially on gas chemistry and developed under the influence of British scientists. In 1771, he married Marie-Anne Polze and received great support from his wife. She translated his writings into English and translated the works of English authors into French. Marie-Anne Polze also became known as a scientific adventurer by marrying Count Rumford, who was known for his observations on temperature while supervising the manufacture of barrels for Prussian cannons. After Lavoisier's death, when Berzelius visited Paris, he observed Baroness Rumford's impressive demeanor in a hall full of scientists. After the 1789 revolution, Lavoisier worked for the newly established state and served as a commissioner to spread the metric system. But the idea that he served the old order and was an extension of the tax collectors could not erase his stain. He was put on trial, like other tax collectors, and became famous for saying that the state does not need intellectuals. Whether or not this doctrine was actually defended, Lavoisier was found guilty of evil intentions and executed in 1794. Lavoisier's work was concerned with the phenomenon of combustion and was influenced by the work of John Mayow 100 years earlier. Mayow had done research on the air dilution of combustion and respiration, but Stephen Hales, in 1724, focused on elasticity, ignoring the different components of gases. In 1774, Priestley conducted experiments to investigate the breathable part of air and made important findings. These experiments led to the discovery of a new type of air, oxygen, which was identified as breathable air. Priestley completely misinterpreted his discovery and did not follow Mayow's thinking. He believed in the phlogiston theory, according to which a substance called phlogiston is released from the air during combustion and respiration, which changes the air. Believing that atmospheric air was a simple and basic substance, he interpreted his invention as a mixture of air containing less phlogiston than atmospheric air. Therefore, according to Priestley, the air he found was more favorable for fueling combustion and respiration because it contained less phlogiston than atmospheric air. With this in mind, he concluded, "We can make the air purer than atmospheric air, that is, air free of phlogiston, air containing less phlogiston than atmospheric air." Lavoisier's solution was quite simple. He revisited Mayow's idea that air is a mixture of a kind of gas that is breathable and favors combustion, and a kind that is poisonous and does not favor life. In reviewing Priestley's theory and his interpretations of the chemical phenomena, it strengthened my feeling that the situation was different. I had already shown some evidence that a thick portion of the atmospheric air after combustion is poisonous, constituting 3/4 of the combustion and more or less losing its pure breathable state. Lavoisier tested this view experimentally. In a delicious irony, he used the same method used to prepare pure air, heating mercury oxide to recover the lost part of the air. But the trick here was this: the mercury oxide was already formed from the slow combustion of the air in the sample taken. Lavoisier describes his experiment as follows. "In a suitable apparatus, I confined 50 cubic inches of ordinary air, into which I put 4 ounces of very pure ova, and, keeping it there for 12 days, I set about oxidizing it at a temperature almost at boiling. On the 12th day, after extinguishing the fire and cooling the vessel, I observed that the volume of the air they contained had diminished by 1/6 of its volume. At the same time, a considerable amount of calcified oxide had formed, which the reduced air extinguished the candles. In short, it was reduced to a completely toxic state." Bringing oxidation and respiration together to form a new theory was Lavoisier's focus. To this end, he worked more on the respiratory process. Lavoisier showed that the air contaminated during respiration is exactly like the air obtained from lime, which contains acid. During respiration, carbon dioxide was expelled while breathable air was absorbed. But some predictions were misleading. For example, a guess such as metals form red slags with fully breathable air, could this explain the red color of the snow, was trying to explain Priestley's discovery in the wrong way. Lavoisier's experiments, when carried out with precise measurements, yielded impressive results. He embarked on quantitative studies of combustion by measuring the absorption of air in the calcification process and estimating the weight of the absorbed air. Furthermore, using a different metal, tin, he was able to calculate the amount of oxygen consumed by measuring the amount of tin before and after calcification. These experiments may not seem entirely convincing by modern standards, but the thesis that the amount lost from the air during calcification was equal to the amount of oxide gained was consistent with Lavoisier's explanation. After Lavoisier, developments in the chemistry of gases took the form of successive improvements, rather than radical innovations of the type of experiments initiated by Mayow, reorganized by Cavendish and Priestley, and germinated by Lavoisier's contributions. More accurate quantitative methods emerged in the 19th century, but it was only with these methods that precise comparisons could be made between the weights of gases and the weights of compounds formed by combining these gases. Lavoisier seriously misunderstood the role of oxygen in inorganic chemistry. In some respects, it seems that Lavoisier could not completely get rid of old ideas. For example, in the case of fire, it was thought, as before, that there was a special interaction between phlogiston and fire, which was evident, for example, in the effect of fire on the elasticity of air. Lavoisier, on the other hand, thought that oxygen was the primary active component of acids. Lavoisier's use of the term oxygen for gases was also based on this misunderstanding, since it meant acid producer.